Murder in Tuscany by L.B. Hathaway. Read by Clare Wille. December 1924 to March 1925, Central London. Prologue. Posie Parker, London's premier female detective, found herself running away on Christmas Eve. Only as far as her office, mind, but running nonetheless. This was odd because things should have been perfect. Posie was newly married, and her husband, Richard Lovelace, Chief Commissioner of Scotland Yard, had just moved into her specially renovated flat at the top of Museum Chambers in Bloomsbury, opposite the British Museum. He'd moved in with his sweet little daughter, Phyllis, and his housekeeper, Masha. There was another daughter too, a beautiful blonde baby, Katie. An orphan, she'd been adopted by Richard and Posie at birth, but despite being more than 6 months old, she was still small and sickly and remained in the expert care of Great Ormond Street Hospital. Besides this one absence, they were virtually a ready-made family, ready to spend a wonderful Christmas together. That was the plan, anyhow. But Posie was finding things tiring, because she was pregnant, only 4 months along, but feeling every day of it like an eternity. The holiday week had started on Monday in a suffocating blur of London smog and rain, with a couple of carol concerts thrown in for good measure, and a visit to see baby Katie. Everything was ready for the festivities to begin at Museum Chambers. There were sugar paper garlands hung about the flat, and a huge Christmas tree. A splendid side of beef with all the trimmings had already arrived from Harrod's Food Hall, which Posie felt sick at the sight of. But that was nothing unusual. She felt sick most of the time, in fact. Wretched. And dear, darling Richard, always so manly and commanding, wasn't making any of it any better. He was fussing over Posie, and she was starting to feel slowly suffocated. She'd tried parking him in an armchair on several occasions, with her copy of the latest Agatha Christie, The Man in the Brown Suit, but he just didn't sit down for very long. It was exasperating. Today, Tuesday, was Christmas Eve, and Richard, mid-morning, had taken Phyllis off on an impromptu last-minute shopping trip to Covent Garden, and Posie had grabbed up her carpet bag and fled. So here she was, plodding up the familiar steep staircase with its awful old blue carpet to the second floor of the building on Grape Street where her detective agency was housed. Out on the landing in the dim grey light, pausing outside the glass stenciled door to the office, she was surprised to hear voices inside. The place was supposed to be empty. It was Christmas, after all. Intrigued, softly pushing open the door, Posie almost fell over the outstretched legs of Len Irving, her business partner. He was lying face down on the carpet of the waiting room, with Sydney, the teenage office boy, hovering eagerly nearby. The fire was blazing in the hearth, and the entire floor was covered in the photographs which were Len's stock in trade. There were at least 100 photographs here, all numbered with small orange stickers. Len was calling out numbers for Sydney, and the lad was busy gathering up the chosen photographs and taping them into a smart black scrapbook-type book, which rested on a nearby desk. Alarmed, both Len and Sydney turned as Posie stepped into the room, their faces relaxing immediately.
"Oh, it's just you, miss."
"That's right, Sydney. Just me. I thought you'd be with your mother today. We agreed you could have the whole week off for Christmas, didn't we?" Sydney grinned.
"We ain't got a nice roaring fire like this over in Leytonstone, miss. Nor as much excitement."
"Excitement?"
"Yeah, Mr. Irving got a message to me yesterday evening that he'd had a tip-off. He needed some help and would I like to join him? I weren't going to say no, was I? He's going to train me up. We picked up these little beauties early this morning from the dark room on the Strand. And now here we are."
Posie put down her carpet bag and inspected some of the images on the floor. They showed a man in black tie on some fancy stone steps, knocking at a shiny painted door, arms reaching out for him, and the door closing. Then there was another group of photographs, obviously taken through a window this time, at close range. These photographs were tense, stolen moments, private moments, an embrace, hands everywhere. The same man in black tie, in his 50s perhaps, with an immaculate handlebar moustache, together with a girl in her early 20s wearing a feather boa and not much else. Expanses of delicate flesh. The girl had very distinctive eyes, like a cat's, with black feline darts of eyeliner. Posie's face burned in a way which was nothing to do with the fire in the room. Len laughed at Posie.
Oh, Po, don't come the old prim buttoned-up governess with me. You and I both know what goes on in the world. This one's a cracker and no mistake. Simon Devereen, of all people, at the Pink House in Soho. The prize rotter. Cavorting and with such a lovely wife at home. She apparently suspected something was afoot. Hired lawyers. She was blooming well right. She'll be able to divorce him now. I always thought he was a bit holier than thou, but he's just a regular man after all. And best of all, last night's little jolly was very well paid. Sid here will get a nice little Christmas bonus out of it too. Can't be bad, can it?
Posie bit her lip. Truth be told, she'd never found Len's contribution to the business very salubrious. Len was a shadower, the best in London. He worked for divorce lawyers, trailing around after an agreed target, usually attempting to catch the target in the business of committing adultery. Len's photographs, often riskily obtained, were usually vital to a case. The nails in the coffin on a marriage, the last straw, a truth laid bare.
Devereen. Yes, quite. Congratulations.
She sunk down in Prudence, the secretary's empty chair, feeling a surge of thankful relief at being off her feet. She watched as Len and Sydney continued to work, the images on the floor steadily reducing in number. Posie's thoughts idly turned to the identity of the man whose photographs were on the floor.
Devereen.
Simon Devereen was a popular and famous Member of Parliament. His seat was somewhere in the Home Counties, although he lived for the most part in London. He'd been very senior in the Royal Air Force during the Great War, and he carried the easy glamour and the danger of those days with him still. But these achievements alone hadn't made him notorious. Two other things had done that. The first was his non-inherited wealth, a colossal fortune obtained in risky ventures, mainly overseas. A fortune made after the Great War had finished. A fortune which had propelled Devereen into the top echelons of society and onto the boards of charitable foundations everywhere. His second source of notoriety was his wife, Lady Nella Harewood. The girl was half his age, a golden-haired beauty who came from an ancient but distinctly impoverished noble family, direct cousins of the British royal family, a girl about whom little had been known before the marriage. But since her nuptials with Devereen a couple of years back, Nella Harewood had become quite the thing. She was very photogenic and was frequently in the newspapers, usually in a flimsy party dress, and tantalisingly, usually looking downright miserable. There had been one image in particular earlier in the year which seemed to have stuck in the public's mind. Of Nella at some summer party, looking glum and clutching at her bloodied nose. Insinuations of bad behaviour and violence on Devereen's part had abounded, tarnishing the man's name. To get a divorce on English soil, still highly scandalous, you either had to wait for 5 years and live apart, or prove adultery and be done with the thing instantly. Well, Nella Harewood now had all the proof she liked. Posie looked at Len, standing with his hands on his hips, doing a last professional reckoning.
Are you going to get home for Christmas Eve afternoon, Len?
He shook his head decisively.
Nah, not if I can help it. Aggie's got parents over. Besides, you know how it is, this is my busiest time of year. I've at least another 4 targets on my list to trail. Even tomorrow, Christmas Day, can you believe it? Lucky for me, I've got Sydney here to help out.
Posie was glad the business was going well for Len. By contrast, Christmas was always her quietest time of year. She'd enjoyed a jaunty, unexpected little case a week or so back, involving a very famous and glamorous American, but that was unusual at this time of year. And besides, that bit of sparkle was now long gone. For a second, she felt sad. Len caught her gaze.
Put the kettle on, Sid, will you? Cuppa's all round. Rustle up some biscuits too, eh, lad?
While Sidney trotted off obediently to the kitchen, Len pulled up a chair. He pretended to flick casually through the day's newspaper. The Times was full of the story about the hero climber Neville Coleman. The much-celebrated man was fast becoming the stuff of legend, and his hugely publicised attempt to climb the as-yet-unconquered north face of the Eiger Mountain in Switzerland had filled the newspapers now for weeks, but not in a good way. He'd started the climb in the third week of November and had disappeared within days. He had been missing for more than 1 month now. The day's news was all about yet another rescue mission. Len shook his head dismally.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.